name is Preston. They call me P or Big P in the street. I'm from the west side of Chicago, born and raised.
I have three children. Preston is the oldest. Tavares is my middle, and Kamaya, she's my baby girl.
We've been through a lot though, Joe. Me and Bro Joe, we like this, you feel me?
Preston was real evil when we was younger. He stayed doing little devilish things to me and Tavares. Of course, we was the youngest, so me and Tavares used to team up on him, and then we'd get him.
I was a bossy brother, you know. I always think I'm the boss of my brother and sister, so I always give it to it.
It was crazy, Joe, growing up. Man, my brother used to bully us, Joe. Mama used to leave, and he'd make us do his chores, his clothes.
Bossy. Thought he was the daddy. Everybody know that I'm a neat freak. I like my house clean at all times. I gave all my kids chores. And when I leave, Preston make them do his chores. You know, Kamaya and Tavares, they always was on each other. You know, it was always them together. Fresh used to bully them. We was the youngest, so of course we get blamed for everything. But when we got older, me and Tavares started teaming up on him, so he was the one getting in trouble.
I thought I was the man of the house. You know, we had chores. My mother used to have us washing dishes and, you know, cleaning up. Like, it might be my week to clean up the kitchen. If my mama gone, I'm lying to him, telling him it's your week. You know?
Always glad that I had a bigger brother, though, you know, to show me different things, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, he used to bully me, you know what I'm saying? Until I got tired of it one time and we actually, you know what I'm saying, got out. But, man, Joe, it was cool, man, you know? I love him, Joe. Death, ride with him, wrong or right, you feel me?
They already know. They called, I'm coming. I ain't used to play that about my brother and sister. And we all like that, you know? No matter if we mad at each other, we can just get into it with each other. And if they call, need my help, I forget about everything and run straight to help, you know?
He's mama's boy. He got a little mouth on him.
I'm mother's boy, you know? I'm mother's boy, so. You know, growing up, we didn't really have a father. My father died at a young age, so we had a stepfather, you know. Rest in peace. He was a good man. I ain't gonna lie. He taught us a lot. You know, he loved us like we was his real child. I got a son. Now he old son. His name Preston. His name had to be called Little Preston. You know what's crazy? Growing up, because I'm named after my father. So growing up, my family called me Little Preston. You know, it was cool because I ain't have a son then. So when I had my son, I told them that, all right, y'all got to stop calling me little person, you know. And some of them did, and you still got some of them that, you know, still call me little person. I'd be like, cool, little person. My son ain't here. Who you calling? You know, messing with them or whatever. But that's my son name now, little person.
My name's Shamika. I'm Preston Woman. We've been together for a year and 2 months. Touch a
trimby while the way you slash my heart feel like you had it before. The way I kiss your lips feel like I kissed you before.
How I met Preston, he was delivering my pizza, and I ran outside to get it, and he asked for my number, and I told him that he just called my number, and he called me back later that night.
My baby, Jody, you know my baby.
Smile, is how you dress. I like jewelry, and he into the same thing that I'm into.
Man, growing up, I wanted to be something like everybody. I wanted, you know?
He felt like DJ Bell was a clean person, dressed nice, always creased up, smelling good. And he always, right now today, he always, you know, if you ask him where he get his dressing from, he always say that he got it from his uncle.
Uncle DJ Bill, shout out to him. He a known DJ. You know, he always stays sharp, you know. And I got attached to that quick. I wanted to be sharp, you know, so I wanted to be like him as I am.
Press is definitely the dresser out of the family. I think he got his dressing from my mama. She be doing her little thing too, so she passed it down. He got a little sauce from her. At the age of 4, he always liked to keep his gym shoes clean. He always, you know, wanted his pants, and he got to have shoes the same color his shirt. You know, he been dressing it to this day. You know, he's a sharp dresser right now.
Everybody know, you see him, he the freshest nigga in there. Real. Stay sharp, everybody know. Everybody know that press gonna be, he gonna be fly every time you see him. This is where some stuff, he's like, man, I'm bold, man. You know what I'm saying? You can't be wearing them, you can't be out here like that. You know what I'm saying? So, yeah, I definitely got the gift on him, you know what I'm saying? How to dress, everything. Name, brand, stuff, I know it off him.
Press was born with sickle cell at the age of 1. That's when we found out, when he first had his first crisis.
I got sickle cell disease, so I was sick a lot growing up. You know, it stopped me from doing a lot. A lot of blacks get it. You know, it's just, you get it from the trait, like from your mother and your father, they have the trait. It make the child have a full-blown disease.
Man, one day we'll just be chilling and, you know what I'm saying, his legs will start bothering him, you know what I'm saying? We probably got to rush to the hospital.
We all grew up in the same household, so of course we was there through crisis all the time. It was times that we all had to carry him to the car because he couldn't walk. It was hard because he always had a crisis and his father's deceased. So it was just me and my mother.
He was at my grandma's crib one time, and he was in the crib. I remember when we was just kicking it, you know what I'm saying? His legs just started hurting, you know what I'm saying? He was like, man, the crash, his legs, you know what I'm saying? He hollering. You know what I'm saying? I'm looking at him like, damn, I don't know how that feel, but I know it hurt.
One day he woke up out of his sleep, and he started crying, you know, saying that he was in pain. His legs was hurting, his arms was hurting. He said that he was hurting from the top of his head to the bottom of his foot. You know, his head was hurting, his, you know, shoulders, chest, everything. And, you know, that was a scary moment because as a mother, you know, I didn't know what to do.
When the weather changed, I'm sick, bones aching.
Just the weather changed. He at school and a schooler called and was like, you know, can you come get Preston? He's saying, you know, his legs hurt or he can't walk.
He was running up and down the court and my bones just started aching. So he stopped me from running fast. You know, the coach pulled me to the side like, what's going on? I said, I don't know, my legs hurt. I think I'm having a crisis, you know. Instantly told me to sit on the side, call my mother. But I was sick a lot growing up until my doctor found the right medicine. And I'd be cool. I could deal with it now.
So that was his life growing up in and out the hospital, in and out the hospital. But that was a scary moment because to see my child laying in the bed and I couldn't help him.
Day was smooth. I woke up, brushed my teeth, first time I see the sun beam, I checked the weather. Oh, okay, so go in my closet, see what I'm finna wear. You know, got a little jiggy, shout out the dough, got up with my brother, rotate with him, kicking it with him or whatever. And then I get that text from my homie asking me, can I pick up his bike at the shop? Because he at work. He didn't want the shop to close, and his bike stuck in there over the weekend, you know, because it was going to be a nice weekend. The weather was nice. I said, cool. Shot up there, got the bike. Now I'm riding the bike until we get off work, you know. We don't get off work until 9, I think, yeah, about 9. I got up with my other homies and they on bikes, four wheelers. You know, we just riding through the city, you know? And I get a call from one of my homies about a barbecue. So my plan was to put up the bike, go get fresh, get up with my homies for the barbecue. Now I'm trying to see how I'm finna put this bike up and get back to my car. Cause at that time, it's late during the day, like, got 7 something, 8, you know? So everybody I called, but my cousin Quick, I called up. She like, okay, cool, I'll meet you over there to put the bike up. So I'm on my way to my homie crib. I gotta put the bike up, Buddha. I'm riding down Palaz. Next thing you know, I see these bright lights to my right side. It's all I remember seeing, bright lights. Bam. Next time I open my eyes, strangers around me. I'm laid out in the middle of the street. Worst day of my life.
Sir, can you hear me? Tell me your first name. Unresponsive.
Next time I woke up, I was in an ambulance with the neck brace on. So I'm scared, you know? I can't move. I got the neck brace on. I don't know what's going on. They telling me stop moving. We think you're paralyzed.
Claire McComb, MedStar Alpha 109.
When I got the call about the accident, I was actually in Wisconsin Dell on a girls trip. We were sitting, you know, me and my girls, we were sitting up there having fun, drinking. Police called my phone, was like, hello, may I speak to Cynthia? And I'm like, speaking. He was like, I was calling you because your son was in a bad accident. I'm like, what? He was like, your son was in a bad accident. He was on a motorcycle and a car or truck ran the light and hit him.
When they gave me medicine or whatever, it knocked me out. So the next time I woke up, the nurse is like, oh, he woke. The doctor finna come in and talk to you. The doctor came in. Was on the side of my bed. And he was talking calm, very calm, you know.
Right now, they, you know, saying that he can't move. I'm like, what? And as soon as I get off the phone, my girl's like, what happened? And I'm like, I just got a call. They like, come on, let's go. And we got up and, you know, headed back to Chicago. I immediately called my mother, my daughter, my son. Told him to hurry up and go to the hospital.
Was actually out on a, you know, having a little date night, and I received the call from my mom stating that Press was just in a terrible accident and that if I can get down there, because she was in Wisconsin on a girls trip. So good thing I was already downtown, so I was 10 minutes from him, and I got there as fast as I could.
When I got the call that Press was in an accident, I was actually on the phone with my best friend, telling her that I haven't heard from him, and it didn't feel right because we talk every day, all day. And when I hung up the phone from her, that's when his sister Kamaya called me and told me that Press was in an accident. And I got the crying, I hopped up, started putting on plugs, and she was like, Shamika, don't come up here because they're not letting nobody up into the hospital because due to COVID. And I was mad about that.
By the time I did get back to Chicago, it was maybe like 3:00 in the morning, and I couldn't even come to the hospital. I had, you know, my daughter and a couple of cousins, they had went to the hospital.
I was definitely the first person on the scene, arrived at the hospital.
Right, they ain't let nobody in because of COVID, you know, so they kind of messed me up, you know what I'm saying? They messed everybody was just mad.
When I got to the hospital, I asked to speak to the doctor, the nurse. They said that the doctor wasn't available because Preston was going to go in surgery. So they told me that the doctor would give me a call. So I waited outside at least trying to see if someone was going to give me a call. And about 30 minutes later, I received a call from the doctor stating, you know, that the accident was very terrible, and that Preston has to go through emergency surgery at about 5-6 o'clock in the morning, and they were gonna call and keep me updated from there.
He was by my bed all calm. He was like, "Preston, I'm sorry to tell you this, but you're not gonna be able to walk again. You're not gonna be able to move again." He diagnosed me as paralyzed from the waist down. I was devastated. I was hurt. I called my mom and told her I didn't want to be here no more. I didn't want to live. My life is over with. She told me the devil is alive. I got people praying for you. I'm praying for you. You're going to be okay. She told me God got the last say so. Stuck with me, and if it wasn't for my family, the support.
The next morning, I got a call from the doctor stating that they're going to take him down to surgery, and that the accident was very bad, that he had to have back surgery right away.
After the doctor told us that, you know, your son just had surgery, his surgery went well, but your son is going to be paralyzed from the waist down. He would never be able to move again.
Me being me, of course, the doctor, we believe in the doctor, but I'm like, the doctor don't have the last say, so God do. So at the time, my faith was too high to believe that the doctor said, you know, that the doctor said that he couldn't walk. So I just didn't believe it. I couldn't allow it. Like, that's something that I couldn't see.
My daughter and my mother informed me, like, you know, was telling me, like, "Ma, you know, the doctor don't have the last say so. At the end of the day, God got the last word." So I was like, "But the doctor said he's gonna be paralyzed for the rest of his life." So my mother told me to pray, and she don't believe that.
So basically after that, you know, the family, more of the family arrived. We were just outside of Mount Sinai, just waiting. Hopefully we, you know, someone get a chance to go in there. But due to the COVID situation, no one was able to go in there. So we were just communicating, you know, with the doctor via the phone. I was the one doing all that, calling, you know, checking up, seeing who was his nurse for the night. You know, I was the one getting the updates.
There's nothing but God, you know. You know what I'm saying? Because you would, you know what I'm saying? He could have been gone. You know what I'm saying? But thank God he's still here. You know what I'm saying? Willing to, you know what I'm saying, do that and take care of his son and just be alive, man.
So at the time, what's going through my head is death. Like, I didn't want to be here no more. And I'm very close with my mother. So I let my mother know how I was feeling, you know? And of course, you know, she talking me out of it, telling me, "Don't think like that, that I'm gonna be okay. God got to let us say so." You know? She told me to pray. And since that day, I've just been praying.
With the coronavirus going on, no one was able to go to the room. And my brother was calling on FaceTime. He had the doctors, nurses calling. Of course, I was like his lawyer. So of course, I went above and beyond. I'm like, "I don't need to speak to the nurse. I don't need to speak to the doctor. I need to speak to the charge, the person who was charged at this hospital." So I spoke to her, and I'm like, "Look, if can't nobody else come, my mom needs to go see him. My brother needs us right now." So she was like, "Okay, I'll see what I can do." And within a couple of hours, she granted my mom access to come up there. So at that time, my mom's up there, and of course, she's taking care of Press like she the mother she is. And she, you know, she put all us on FaceTime, you know, the group FaceTime. So she telling Press to move his feet, and Press was able to do it, but not really. So at that time, we knew it was gonna be a journey. Like, this is not no easy process, but with the family that he got, we was all supportive. We're still supportive.
I'm so happy to go to therapy, because this therapy is gonna help get me right. That's what the doctor said. I need more therapy. If
I ain't in therapy, I'm in the gym. I signed up for the gym. So I'm definitely working on building my muscles up to be able to walk again. I have to build my muscles up. It's like starting over, being a child.
His girlfriend was like right there. You know, I thank God for her. You know, they was only dealing with each other for like 5 or 6 months, you know, before that happened to him. And I'm, you know, I'm blessed. I'm sorry. I'm blessed that he got up in his life because she didn't have to be there. It was a new relationship. She had to be there. She had, sorry. She had to wash him up. She had to change him. You know, she was there. She got kids. You know, she, it was like around the clock. She had to, if it weren't for his girlfriend being there, I'm thankful for her. I really am. I tell her all the time, I'm thankful for her being there. Because my son, with this condition, he had attitude. He, you know, he used to break down every now and then because this is not what he was used to. He always, you know, on the go and all this other stuff. But at the end of the day, he got back, you know, to what he liked, shopping. He done bought so many clothes, couldn't even walk, shoes and everything. So him buying shoes actually motivated him. Because I used to tell him, you ordering Gucci shoes, you better make sure you can walk in them. And I'm talking about he ordered shoes 3 and 4 times a month.
The struggle was I had to learn how to change him, how to take care of his wound that he had on his booty, and how to use the catheters and all that. But I ended up learning how to maintain everything. Helping him use the washroom, helping him boo-boo, just helping him putting on his shoes, washing his legs and his body up, helping him move around and change places when he's laying in the bed. The hardest task was for me was helping him up and down the stairs. That's all.
I definitely was helping him, you know what I'm saying, but it was messed up. And you see, I never thought I had to, you know what I'm saying, help my brother wash up or, you know what I'm saying, Joe like this. So it definitely was hurtful, you know what I'm saying? I couldn't even do it for, you know what I'm saying, at first. It was hurtful, Joe, you know what I'm saying? But, you know what I'm saying, as times and days got better, Joe, it got good, it got better, you know what I'm saying? He started doing it on his own. And he called me, this nigga want a glass of water. I'm coming over there, you know what I'm saying? Brush his teeth, I'm there for him. You know what I'm saying? To put on his shoes, he couldn't even bend down to, you know what I'm saying, put on his shoes. He couldn't even put his shoes on, so I had to be there. He had to, you know what I'm saying, go somewhere. I had to bring him down the steps, bring him up.
When we started to see that little movement, the feet, you know, the little legs, I knew that the doctor didn't have the last say so. That's why my faith in God was so high. And I'm like, can't nobody, you know, like, don't nobody got the last say so. So the stuff that you hear, you got to believe in God. Like, that's all I say. You have to believe in God.
If he stand up one time, it was over with. We didn't help him stand up no more. Once he learned how to put his shoes on, we didn't help him no more. Everything that Press do now or did one time, we stopped.
Yeah, my mama, she
we didn't handicap him.
I love her to death because she really here. You know, she be on it. Like, she don't play. She come around me. She, boy, get out that chair, stand up. Like, she be on it, you know? And that helped me get very motivated. How she act towards me on getting back, it really helps me to motivate myself. I pushed through her.
It was a struggle, it definitely was. Press couldn't do nothing on his own, from putting his shoes on, putting his clothes, to peeing, to, you know, he couldn't do none of that. So us being us, we made it happen, we helped him. You know, we we help them as much as we can, and look at him today. He definitely blossomed a lot. He came a long way.
Y'all don't even know the situation. It was way serious, you know what I'm saying? It was bigger than that, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, for real, I'd have been that way, you know what I'm saying? Use it on this stuff, I gotta change it, you know what I'm saying? I'm pissed from shit, you know what I'm saying? I gotta change it, you know what I'm saying? Make sure you straight, Joe. That hurted me. I never thought I had to see my brother go through that.
It was difficult because he couldn't pee on his own. He couldn't boo-boo on his own. He couldn't move. It was hard. You know, a lot of people didn't know what he was going through.
His family been a big help to me. I love them all, like brothers and sisters and a mom and grandma.
Support, man. And think about if you was in that position. You know what I'm saying? Because you need somebody. And, you know what I'm saying? Like, you definitely need somebody. This is the time that you really need somebody. You know what I'm saying? To help you get back right. You can't get right if you ain't got no help. You know what I'm saying? You can't even get up to do nothing. You know what I'm saying? So you definitely gotta have that support, motivation. You know what I'm saying? Wanting to get better, wanting to start back walking. And, you know what I'm saying? Do normal things that you know what I'm saying, used to do that you ain't doing.
He on his own, you know. We don't even help him no more. We used to have to help him so much to the point that he needed somebody at the house every day, all day. Now, well, if I have to come get him, you know, if he got to go to therapy, I come over there, I bring the wheelchair down, get on the bus, go to therapy, come back, I go back over there, you know, take the wheelchair, but he can go up and down the stairs by himself, and he be dressed by the time I get there. So, like I say, the doctor told him he was going to be paralyzed, wasn't going to be able to move from the waist down, and the devil is a lie, because my son is walking. He just walking with a cane. You know, he getting there. You know, it's step by step. But when I tell you, it's step by step. Step by step, but he's doing it.
Keep pushing. You know what I'm saying? I act like it ain't enough. You know what I'm saying? Man, you can do better than that. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, I know he's doing good, but I try to make him think. You know what I'm saying? Like, man, that ain't enough, man. You gotta get up more. You gotta do this, what you need to do. You know what I'm saying? Show a lot of
difference,
yo.
Still in therapy right now. I'm gonna stay in therapy until I'm able to walk again.
Everywhere we go, he's cracking jokes on everybody. He, you know, he cracked jokes on his situation right now. If you said he gonna make you laugh somehow, you know, if it's about you, your kids, anybody, he's gonna make you laugh.
Get it back, get it. Ooh, do it. Ooh, ooh, do it back. Ooh, hit it, baby. Hit it. hit it. Do the buka. Ooh. The last thing we did together, we was out of town. We was in Vegas. And we was having him stand up, me and his sister, and talking and walking, joking around. The few things we did was jet skiing that we both didn't like. The ATV, we both didn't like that. But we both tried it to get that off our one of our bucket list. But we loved in Vegas.
I just talked to him, told him he got a 9-year-old son, and I told him he had to be here for his son. You know, he need to be here. He need to be able to walk for his son. And so that motivated him.
My goals right now is to be able to walk again. You know, I can see myself in the park, my son walking, playing, talking to him. I got to get back to that. Yeah, thirsty.
Hopefully the next 5 years, he will be my husband. And we will have our own house that we buy. And we'll be in a happy relationship with our kids.
the woman I got now, I ain't gonna lie, I gotta keep it real. In 5 years, I see myself somewhere married. You feel me? Somewhere on the island, feet kicked up.
So when my son got depressed, I was taking him somewhere. And I told him, let's go to the park. It was a vacant lot, Target. And I told my son, drive. He was like, Mom, I can't drive. I can't move. I can't move my legs. I said, trust me, you can drive. He driving, you know, doing the car like this. So as he doing the car like that, you know, he had to push his leg down.
I look at life different. I don't look at life the same. I look at life different. Your life can be took away just like this. And snap of the finger, Joe, for real.
Press learn. He just got a different outlook on life. You know what I'm saying? Sometimes when you young and you running around in the street, you know, you're moving fast. So you don't really got time to think about a lot of stuff you're doing until sometimes, you know, like I tell them, man, I'm not saying that out of every bad situation, something good happened. So God could have just slowed it down for you. He didn't take you, but he just wanted to slow you down to help you get better control of your own life.
Oh, Mo, I definitely appreciate you too, bro. For real love, bro. I look at you like a real brother, bro. You've been there for me since day one, Joe. I ain't even talking about just off the accident. I'm talking about period, bro. You've been there for me, Joe, for real. If you ever need anything from me, Joe, you know, you can call me. I got you, bro.
Now you might think of it as a bad situation because you can't get up and you can't walk and do the normal stuff you used to do, but you still here. God don't put nothing on you can't handle.
It's like they had shifts, for real. Grandma got the morning, Mama got the afternoon, my girl got the rest of the day. Like, they had real shifts, for real. They was there for the kid, man. Grandma, thank you. I appreciate you being there for me. I love you. Grandma ain't play. I used to wake up. Grandma in my house cooking breakfast. I'm about to grab the pole. Oh, that's granny. I learned to don't take life for granted, Joe. Like, I be on it so much. Like, I don't even be outside late no more. I'm just taking... Looking at my life totally different, you know. I could have lost my life the day this accident happened. So it just helped me stay on point, look at life different. You know I never get on a bike again, that's for sure.
I think this situation has made him gain more patience, save more, still shopping the same, but he learned how to save a little bit better.
He a fighter, you feel me? Definitely a fighter, you know what I'm saying? So, he come back there, you know what I'm saying?
My goal for my brother for 2021 is to be out this wheelchair. Stop using it. He has done a great job. Like, he done even learned how to cook with his little air fryer. Like, I'm telling you, he done came a long ways. But my goal is to be out of it, like completely out of it. Of course, you know, he need it now, but I must say he don't use it as much as he did in the beginning.
Progress I saw Press make is walking, driving, and standing up more. I never believed that Preston was never going to walk again. I always had a feeling that he was going to walk. Today is the day before Father's Day, and I would like to wish Preston a happy Father's Day. I love you, babe.
My advice to everybody else, don't give up. Just keep pushing, keep pushing. I know it's going to be days and times that you're going to want to give up, don't want to go through this, like, just tired of it. I was the same way. I wanted to give up. And some just told me to keep pushing. You know, I think about my son. I got to be here for him. As you look at it, I'm living for him. I ain't even living for me no more. I'm finna be 35 years old this year. I'm living for him. I ain't living for me no more, yo. So don't take life for granted, man. Try to eat better. Man, just be on point.
For those who in the situation that I am, But I mean, y'all gotta stay focused, stay determined. You feel me? Like, I know some of y'all might not have that family support, you know, that good family system. But you just gotta keep pushing, keep pushing. Don't give up. I know it's crazy coming from me, from a person that almost gave up, that was really actually trying to give up. And I thank God that I didn't give up, because I'm happy that the man that I'm becoming today, like, I'm pushing through everything. Like, you can't hold nothing up in front of me. I'm knocking it down. I'm coming through all that. Ain't no giving up. Ballad. Never heard of the ballad? We very strong.